Hi everybody. In the previous video, we thought about how to take everything that we know about the hydrogen atom and extend it to at least approximately solve for the wave functions and energies of a multi-electron atom. In this video, we're going to introduce one more concept, the idea of electron spin, and then use that to build up the trends in the periodic table that we've probably seen in general chemistry. As we've already discussed, the spatial part of an atomic orbital is associated with three quantum numbers. N, L, and M sub L. The principal quantum number N determines an electron's energy and the size of the orbital. The angular momentum quantum number L determines the orbital's shape, and the magnetic quantum number M sub L determines in what direction the orbital points. There's a fourth quantum number that you may have seen, M sub S, the spin quantum number, and we're going to talk a bit about that now. Electron spin was first demonstrated in the Stern-Gerlach experiment, which showed that electrons behave as tiny magnets. In this experiment, a beam of atoms that have an unpaired electron is shot through a non-uniform magnetic field. In this figure, the atoms are hydrogen atoms, but they can be any atoms that have an unpaired electron, like silver, for example. When the atoms go through the magnetic field, they're deflected in one of two directions, depending on whether the electron is spin up or spin down. In other words, whether the electron has a spin quantum number of positive 1/2 or negative 1/2. When we hear the word spin, it's tempting to think of the electrons as spinning around like a top, but really the electrons aren't spinning the way we classically think of spin. The spin that an electron has can be thought of as just another source of angular momentum. We already know that the spatial part of atomic orbitals has angular momentum associated with it. We learned that the orbital angular momentum has a magnitude of h bar times the square root of L times L plus 1, and that one component of the angular momentum, which we typically call the z component, has a magnitude of h bar times m sub L. And we know that there are constraints on these quantum numbers. L has to be a non-negative integer, and m sub L, because it represents a component of L, can only range from negative L to L. Spin angular momentum works in a similar way. The magnitude of an electron's spin angular momentum is h bar times the square root of s times s plus 1. And one component of that spin is equal to h bar times m sub s. So it looks like we're introducing two new quantum numbers here, s and m sub s. But that's not really true. Because it turns out that for electrons, s always has the same value, 1/2. So we never really talk about s because it's always the same. But we do talk about m sub s, because it can take on two different values, positive or negative 1/2. You can see that this is kind of analogous to the way that m sub l can only range from negative l to l. M sub s can only range from negative s to s. So any electron can have a spin quantum number of m sub s equals either positive or negative 1/2. Now that we've introduced spin, we can say that the full wave function of an electron is a function of three spatial coordinates and also a spin. The wave function is expressed as a product of a spatial part and a spin part, psi of either x, y, and z, or r, phi, and theta, times a spin that we call alpha or beta, spin up or spin down. There are just a couple more concepts that we need to introduce before we arrive at trends in the periodic table, and one of those is the Pauli exclusion principle. You may have seen the Pauli exclusion principle before in general chemistry. The version that you've probably heard before is that no two electrons in an atom can have the same set of four quantum numbers. The important consequence of this is that only two electrons, one with a spin quantum number of positive 1/2 and the other with negative 1/2, can occupy the same spatial orbital. So, for example, an s orbital can only hold two electrons. The version that you probably haven't heard, which we can say now, is that because electrons are what we call fermions, the sign of the wave function has to change when two electrons are switched. If we had two electrons in the same spatial orbital with the same spin, for example, the wave function shown at the bottom of the screen where two electrons are in a 1s orbital with spin alpha, then if we switch those two electrons, if we switch the 1 and the 2 in parentheses, the sign of the wave function wouldn't change. So, consistent with our earlier understanding of the Pauli exclusion principle, it's impossible to have two electrons in the same spatial orbital that also have the same spin. I'd also like to remind us of what's called the Aufbau principle, the idea that in the ground state of an atom or molecule, electrons prefer to occupy the lowest energy orbitals available. So, for example, the first two electrons in the ground state of an atom occupy the 1s orbital. Textbooks will often have mnemonics for trying to remember what orbitals fill in what order, but I usually find those sorts of mnemonics to be confusing, because really all we need is the periodic table. If you remember that the left two columns in the periodic table correspond to the filling of s orbitals, and the six columns on the right in the main group correspond to the filling of p orbitals, and then we have the transition metal block in the middle that corresponds to the filling of d orbitals, and the lanthanides and actinides that correspond to the filling of f orbitals, the periodic table really tells us everything we need to know. So let's think about the electron configurations of the first few elements in the periodic table. In its ground state, a hydrogen atom has its electron in a 1s orbital, so we can write the electron configuration as 1s1, and we can draw it as either an up arrow or a down arrow, corresponding to whether the electron is spin up or spin down. Helium has two electrons in the 1s orbital, and we know that one of them has to be spin up and the other one spin down. In lithium, the third electron goes into a 2s orbital. In beryllium, the fourth electron also goes into 2s, with the opposite spin. And in boron, the fifth electron goes into a 2p orbital. Notice that these electron configurations are written as if we're multiplying together atomic orbitals. We saw in the previous video that, at least in an approximate sense, this is true. Multi-electron wave functions are approximately products of one-electron wave functions. When it comes to writing the ground state electron configuration of the next element, carbon, we have a choice. Do we put the sixth electron in the same spatial orbital as the fifth with the opposite spin, or do we put it in another orbital with the same spin or with the opposite spin? Hund's rule is an experimental guideline that answers this question. If more than one orbital of the same energy is available, then electrons tend to fill orbitals with parallel spins before pairing. In the case of carbon, this means that the sixth electron goes into a different spatial orbital than the fifth with the same spin. So, based on the Aufbau principle, the Pauli exclusion principle, and Hund's rule, we can write the electron configurations for the rest of the second row of the periodic table, or for any element we want. I should mention that there are some exceptions to the Aufbau principle, but in my opinion, they're not really worth memorizing. The pink squares in the periodic table on this slide show exceptions to the Aufbau principle. These exceptions typically arise from the fact that some orbitals, for example, ns orbitals and n-1d orbitals, are very close to each other in energy. So sometimes the preference for spin can outweigh the preference for orbital energy. For example, in the case of chromium, it's more favorable to have 5d electrons and 1s electron that all have the same spin than what the Aufbau principle would dictate, which would be 2s electrons and 4d electrons. When an element has a large number of electrons, the full electron configuration can be cumbersome to write. So as you've probably seen in general chemistry, it's possible to abbreviate the electron configuration of an element using its noble gas core. For example, a ground state silicon atom has electrons in the 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, and 3p orbitals. But as chemists, we know that the core electrons, the ones with n equals 1 and 2, aren't really doing much. Those orbitals don't really get involved in bonding or reactions. It's mainly the electrons in valence orbitals, 3s and 3p, that get involved in bonding and reactions. So we can think of the electron configuration of silicon as having the same noble gas core as neon, and then a few additional valence electrons. So often, we'll write the electron configuration of silicon as a neon core with 3s2, 3p2. The last thing that I wanted to say about ground state electron configurations is to briefly mention what happens in ions. We can think of ions as just neutral atoms that have gained or lost electrons. And for main group elements, ions gain or lose electrons as we would expect according to the Aufbau principle. So I'd like you to think for a few seconds about what the electron configurations of sodium plus and sulfide 2 minus are. As we would expect, the electron configuration of sodium plus is the same as neutral sodium, except that it's lost its 3s electron. So it's 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. And the electron configuration of sulfide 2 minus is the same as neutral sulfur, except that it's gained 2 electrons in the 3p orbitals. So it's 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6. The main exception to this comes in the case of transition metal cations. Transition metal cations tend to lose their s electrons before their d electrons, which contradicts the Alpha-Bau principle. So, I'll give you a few seconds to think about what you think the electron configuration of iron 2 plus is. Hopefully you said that it loses 2 electrons from its 4s orbital, so it's 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 3d6. I'd like to spend the last few minutes of this video talking about trends in the periodic table in ionization energy and electron affinity. Ionization energy is defined as the energy required to remove an electron from a neutral atom in the gas state. So it's the change in energy associated with the reaction shown on the slide, where some gas phase atom X becomes an X plus cation and an electron. So I'd like you to think for a few seconds about how you would expect the ionization energy to change across a period of the periodic table and also down a group. When it comes to ionization energies, the trend to remember is that the top right corner of the periodic table, the helium corner, has the highest ionization energies. Those are the elements from which it's most difficult to remove an electron. So, as we move from left to right on the periodic table, ionization energies increase. The reason that's usually given for that trend is that as we take a step from left to right on the periodic table, we're adding both a proton and an electron. Each additional proton means that the nucleus is more positively charged and holding on tighter to each electron. So even though the additional electron partially cancels out that effect, all the electrons in that atom still feel a larger effective nuclear charge. They still feel a stronger pull from the positive charge of the nucleus that makes it more difficult to remove an electron. As we move from top to bottom on the periodic table, remember that the atomic orbitals get larger, and it's easier to pluck an electron out of a larger orbital that's far away from the nucleus than it is a smaller orbital. There are some small exceptions to these trends that are worth mentioning. The two red boxes on this slide illustrate a couple of these exceptions. As you go from beryllium to boron, or from nitrogen to oxygen, you would expect the ionization energy to increase, but it actually decreases a little bit. I'd like you to think for a few seconds about why that is. We can think about these based on electron configurations. When we remove the highest energy electron from beryllium, it's coming out of the 2s orbital. But when we remove the highest energy electron from boron, it's coming out of the higher 2p orbital. So despite the usual trend, if we think about what orbitals are actually involved, we can understand why we see what we see. The trend from nitrogen to oxygen is a little bit more subtle, because both of those elements are having an electron taken out of the 2p orbitals. But remember, it's particularly energetically favorable to have all of the electrons lined up with parallel spins. And when you remove an electron from oxygen, it's left with 3 electrons in the 2p orbitals, and all 3 of those can have parallel spins. Just as the first ionization energy is defined as the amount of energy required to eject the first electron from a neutral atom, the second and third ionization energies are defined as the amount of energy required to kick out the second and third electron. To try to wrap our minds around this, I'd like to pose the following question. The 4 ionization energies of beryllium are successively about 900, 1800, 15,000, and 21,000 kilojoules per mole. And the question is, why are electrons in a beryllium atom so much harder to remove after the first 2? Hopefully you again thought about the orbitals that are involved in these processes. The first and second electrons that are kicked out of a beryllium atom come from the 2s orbital. But after that, the only electrons remaining have to come out of the lower energy 1s orbital, which is much more difficult to do. Finally, let's talk briefly about electron affinity, which is sort of complementary to the idea of ionization energy. Electron affinity is defined as the energy released when an electron is added to a neutral atom, and the sign convention for electron affinity is that it's positive when an atom wants to add an electron. So roughly speaking, ionization energy is a measure of how much an atom wants its last electron, while electron affinity is a measure of how much an atom wants an additional electron. So as you can imagine, they're related to each other. We know from our periodic trend in ionization energy that as we move to the right in the periodic table, from, for example, oxygen to fluorine to neon, the ionization energy increases. How do you expect the electron affinities of these elements to compare? I'll give you a few seconds to think about it. In general, we know that atoms hold on more tightly to their electrons as we move to the right in the periodic table. For that reason, electron affinity increases as we go from oxygen to fluorine. But as you can see, the electron affinity suddenly gets very small when we go to neon. The reason for that, again, comes down to orbitals. An additional electron in both oxygen and fluorine goes into the 2p orbitals. But in neutral neon, the 2p orbitals are already filled, and the next electron has no choice but to go into the much higher energy 3s orbital. The periodic trend in electron affinity is a little bit less straightforward than the trend for ionization energy. In general, electron affinity does increase from left to right, but there are plenty of exceptions. The values are typically the highest for halogens and the lowest for noble gases. That's all for now.